because umpires will only suspend play when they consider there is a risk of serious physical injury to the batsman. And that certainly wouldn't be the case with Jimmy Adams and Heath Arpiton bowling, but it could be for the wicketkeeper. He doesn't get a mention in the playing condition. With no more runs added, up to the moment the umpires took the players off for rain and bad light. 347 for 7, some very, very good performances there. Atherton and Thorpe started the day, Thorpe having come out in place of Crawley, who was out to the last ball yesterday. Atherton 47, a very good decision there from Cyril Mitchley to have him caught behind by Murray off Ambrose. A wonderful knock from Graham Thorpe. I thought the equal at least of the one he made in Perth against the Australians. Robin Smith 44, that was an excellent partnership between Thorpe and Smith. White 23, everyone contributed there. Russell run out for 35, and Watkinson making his debut as a batsman in the Test match, 25, and Dominic Cork 3 came in just before that bad light took them away. And the bowling figures for West Indies, they worked very hard out there. There was the incident with Courtney Walsh earlier in the day and the two umpires. He finished up with 2 for 66 from 28 overs and 5 maidens. Ambrose, 2 for 69, had problems with his run-up, but they did work and work and work there. Bishop, 24 overs, 3 maidens, 1 for 85 and 1 for 66 for Kenny Benjamin, who kept on producing that extra fast delivery to discomfort the batsman. Towards the end, Adams and Arthurton bowled and got through their overs fairly quickly. So England, 347 for 7. They're 131 runs ahead, and that...
He was on... And now on BBC Two, highlights from the fourth test at Old Trafford with Richie Beno.
Graham Thorpe played a magnificent innings yesterday at Old Trafford. He's a fine young batsman, and he was one of those who saw England into a very good position on the third morning of this match. 150 would be a good lead, 200 would be even better, and then West Indies will need to bat with great discipline. And just bear in mind too that Carl Hooper has broken the index finger of his right hand. John Embery is one who could play a big part in the last 3 days of this fascinating contest. It'll be very dangerous, though, to write off the West Indies. They're a great cricket team, even though they've been beaten 3 times in recent months. Well, welcome to the highlights of the third day's play of this contest at Old Trafford, the Cornhill Test match, the 100th one they've sponsored, and a very, very good game of cricket it is. This is the way it started on the third morning. 347 for 7 England, with Thorpe 94, Smith 44, White 23, Russell 35, and Watkinson 25 not out, going in this morning with Dominic Cork, who's on 3. The bowling figures for West Indies, that reflects what England did yesterday. It was a very courageous fight. Ambrose 2 for 69, Walsh 2 for 66, Bishop 1 for 85, and Benjamin 1 for 66. And just a reminder of the way the match stands. West Indies 216 all out, great bowling performance from England, and England in reply 347 for 7, and they are 131 runs ahead. And here's Geoffrey Boycott now with his pitch report.
Third morning, lots of sunshine around, and this pitch has lost its greenness. It's getting drier, a more yellowy straw colour. This is a seam bowler's length. There's no green grass at all. It's still firm. It's quite good for batting, but this is what's happening down on a spinner's length. You see here all the footmarks. It's really dry. There's no grass at all. And if you look here, this is where the England spinners should come into their own. Look at these here. These are stud marks here. Some bowlers have been allowed to run on the pitch. Great big holes, cracks here disintegrating. Spinners love this. Edge of the foot holes here. There should be something for the England off-spinners to work on against the West Indies right-handers, and particularly the two left-handers, Lara and Adams. Look here. I'd like a bowl on this if I was the spinner, and I think England will be looking forward to a good long bowl with their spinners and to bowling West Indies out.
Well, that's sounding quite good so far as England are concerned. We're going to join play now in the first over. Courtney Walsh is the bowler. He's bowling from the Stretford end. The batsman is Dominic Cork. Now watch closely and listen very carefully as well. Nice start and a good confidence boost to see the 350 come up with an all-run four. Now this is the four struck by Dominic Cork through the covers off the back foot off Courtney Walsh last over. That is what happens. Everyone was following the flight of the ball, including your commentator. And his back foot has gone back onto the stumps. Now he pushes off to take the first of the four runs they ran. As he did so, and his foot touched the stumps, the bail fell off. Just like that. Now, umpire Mitchley saw it. You might remember I said that umpire Mitchley had come in to put the bail back on, make sure it was put back on by Dominic Cork, who had had the common sense to pick it up and mark his block.
Yes, it's all going England's way, and very quickly too. This is a thickish edge. He's trying to run it a little bit, but not quite that fine, look.
Ah, good running. That's good cricket. And Watkinson did well to pay attention to the call. He didn't know where it had gone.
Oh, he's taken it. The rebound taken at first slip. Junior Murray at least got something on it just to knock it up. And Stuart Williams, the substitute fielder, actually had a pretty simple job to do.
Well, it was good innings by Mike Watkinson. Played well his first test match. He's getting a terrific ovation by his home crowd.
Junior Murray just had to change direction a little bit, but he got that right hand on it and knocked it up. So the wicket is taken. Good shot. Not even Keith Arthurson will catch that one. Very well played by Dominic Cork. Well, pick that out. Pass it away behind square. Dominic Cork really enjoying himself out there this morning.
Well, if I described one before as an excellent shot, that's very reminiscent of Viv Richards playing on the up, ball of not great pace, but certainly not slow, and hitting it through back foot point for four. That's as good a shot that you would have seen.
Well, a
that somehow slipped very fine down to third man. Kept low from Courtney Walsh. Somehow Dominic Cork managed to guide it down there. Fine shots. Straight down the ground. Kirtley Ambrose is never going to catch it. And England cruised past the 400 mark. 402 for 8.
Well, the Embury prod has been productive for many years now. Very disheartening for a bowler to find the edge and see the ball skimming away for four. Well, that's a wonderful shot. If it's up, you've got to hit it. And the applause around the ground is for the 200 lead coming up.
Got him. That's onto the stumps. John Embury is gone. The backward defensive not solid enough. It ran down onto the stumps off the bat and probably something else as well. And so John Embry is gone for 8. But it's been a handy knock. Dominic Cork has been in such good form at the other end that the partnership is another handy effort for England. Dominic Cork. There it is, 50 for Dominic Cork. His maiden Test match 50. And he's well entitled to celebrate. All his England colleagues on the balcony there applauding his efforts. And he's played wonderfully well this morning. He's run brilliantly between the wickets. He's cracked the ball to the boundary 7 times in that innings of 50. It's taken him just 73 balls and 1 minute short of 2 hours. Very important innings for him, very worthy innings for England. That's straight into the hands of Jimmy Adams at short leg. Courtney Walsh has his final reward for this innings. And England are all out for 437. Angus Fraser, the man out, caught by Jimmy Adams off Courtney Walsh for 4. And another painful blow for Angus Fraser on that left hand. Pretty high up as well, I think. Just as far as England are concerned, they'll be hoping there's nothing, no serious damage done there. But Dominic Cork leading the way back in. 56 not out. His maiden Test match half century. That's been a wonderful effort by him.
It certainly was. 56 not out there from Dominic Cork, and great partnerships all the way down there in the England side. 19 was the lowest, that was between Cork and Fraser for the last wicket. 64 extras in all, 437 all out, and the West Indian bowling figures, well, they show precisely what happened out there. 2 wickets for Ambrose, 4 for Walsh, he's in there again, a great competitor. Bishop 2 for 103 and Benjamin 1 for 83. The match situation, West Indies 216 all out, and England, when their innings finished at 437, with 221 runs ahead. We join play now in the West Indies second innings. It's the first over and the second ball. One run has been added. Angus Fraser is the bowler and Arthurton is taking strike.
And a big appeal down the leg side. Angus Fraser, Jack Russell and John Crawley at short leg all asking the question. Fine shot. And that escapes away down the leg side. Just nudged wide of Jack Russell by the pad, so we have four leg byes. Well, a lot of shouting around the slips there, but I don't understand how they could see very much. That's pitched outside the leg stump. That looked a painful blow. Arthurton catching the thumb or index finger. Well, he must expect the new ball to bounce that extra bit. Dropped.
That's the sort of shot he's looking for, anything pitched up.
That's a fine shot from Keith Arthurton. Got right on top of it, hit it very powerfully.
Yes, it's the right way to play as well. You look to get forward, smother the spin, look to get forward, smother the spin. The bowler then shortens his length. Rock back and crack it off the back foot.
Well, that's climbed, leapt at Sherwin Campbell.
Well, that ball's hit one of the dry, cracked areas that's just breaking up a little bit. It is very dry pitch.
Well, they're asking the question. Beautifully taken by Jack Russell. Really was a lovely piece of work behind the stumps. And Dickie Bird is asking for the assistance of the third umpire, Chris Ballaston. John Embry just getting that ball to turn back in through what was quite a wide gate. A very extravagant drive from Sherwin Campbell, nowhere near the pitch of the ball.
Yes, it's one of those extravagant shots I was talking about. Look at the length, it's nowhere near the length for driving. Oh, he's made it, I think. Yes, he's made it. But there was just a sneaking chance there for Jack Russell. But it was the attempt at the shot. It was a play forward defensive to that sort of length of a ball. Especially when you've got an off-spin who's going to turn it between bat and pad, and yet you're extravagantly trying to hit it against the spin through the covers. There's the foot going back. Just beats Jack Russell. Jack was keen, he saw it.
Well, that one didn't bounce as much. Keith Arthurton holding up his bat, whether or not that's a gesture. Try and indicate to the umpire that there was an inside edge, I've no idea. Yes, I think there was just enough. Pretty clear maybe from that.
Ah!
It took umpire Mitchley a long time to say no there. That's why the law is brought in to stop batsmen just sticking their foot out at the ball. It's the top spinner, one that comes back with the arm, that'll worry the left-handers and worry the umpire. Would the ball have hit the stumps? Oh. I wonder it took umpire Mitchley quite a time to make the decision.
And again, Sherwin Campbell seemed to be in some sort of discomfort.
Sound of some kind, but I reckon on the replay it'll show it beat the outside edge by 2 or 3 inches. Shift opening pair, and Arterton has got, I reckon, halfway down the pitch and then halfway back again, and that is a cruel blow for the West Indies. Campbell's not even watching Arterton, he's only watching the field. Oh, he's got three parts of the way down, I don't believe it. Now the throw's not great, and Arterton did everything he possibly could to get back, but what a schmozzle. And Lara comes out now to join Sherwin Campbell.
Atherton's call, the ball was in front of him. Campbell at least should have reacted, yes or no. I don't think he said anything. He did not even recognize that maybe Atherton was near to him. The return was not a good one. Jack Russell scampering on his knees, but Atherton probably ran out by at least a yard, yard and a half.
Well, I mark this down as good indication of Michael Atherton's increased maturity as a captain. In fact, that he's not just making decisions now, but he's putting them into practice. Out in Australia, I always had the feeling he was right up with the game, but he'd then agonise over a decision. Now, he's made one here where Embury's bowling well, but because of what Cork's done to Lara, he's got him on very quickly. And almost successfully.
Well, everybody went up for this. Immediately, there was no hesitation, and probably just two people out there who would not have thought that was out, and that's the umpire and the batsman.
At four for that. No man down at third man. West Indies will take what they can as regards runs. There's no need for them just to concentrate on defence. If they can wipe off that deficit, then they've got a chance of saving the game.
Yeah, come on.
They split the field perfectly. Outfield is too fast for the fielders. Good square drive. This outfield is baked hard and cut close. He gets four for that, and he's still wringing his hand.
Well, he's not totally in control of this. You see the hand come off, it slices off the face, and fortunately goes in the gap. And I think England will be beginning to think, how much longer can he get away with keep taking that hand off?
Might just have got his fingertips to that, but Lara played it beautifully into the ground. A feeling that might have flicked Sherwin Campbell's glove and then held up, not quite lodging in his pad where it would have been dead, might just have held up in his body. Oh, yes, it did, no. Well, good try, Jack. The ball is dead, whether played or not, when it lodges in the clothing or equipment of a batsman or the clothing of an umpire. And I suppose the interpretation of that is with the umpire. Has the ball lodged? Has it finally settled? Good shot. He's very quick onto that. He's played a good sensible innings, Sherwin Campbell, so far. He's gone to 34.
Well, his footwork, he had to be nimble there. He nearly trod on his wicket. If you watch him go back here. Oh dear, nearly. Well done.
Well, you wouldn't call that grafting, but it's a perfect shot to the ball, which is short, stood up. And that's the 50 partnership. Oh, that's a big shout, a very confident shout. He's gone, he doesn't like it, the batsman walks away. It may be disappointment. A fiddling little shot outside the off stump of Watkinson, and Sherwin Campbell goes to 44, 93 for two.
Well, it was a nothingness shot, really. It's wide of off stump, and he's just trying to sort of run it on the offside. See, the face opens, he's trying to run it behind square. Everybody went up, and I reckon that was out. I think he hoped if he stood, he might get away with it. But I think it's a poor shot, and when he goes back to the dressing room, he reflect that he was induced to play on the offside against the spin with an open face.
That's, I think, the most reliable pair of batsmen the West Indies would have had in recent times. I know it at the wicket.
It's in the air, he's caught and bowled. Beautifully flighted off break. Mike Watkinson. Absolutely bold for that. Jimmy Adams just got a little turn round in it, looking towards the onside maybe. Caught and bowled Watkinson for one, 97 for three. So instead of just defending and blocking into that little cage where the ball might ricochet into the hands of close fielders, he decided to follow through on the drive.
What a start to a test career, starting at your own home ground. He's captain of Lancashire, had a good batting partnership, bowled well in the first innings, now getting perhaps the most important breakthrough, getting Jimmy Adams, because if Adams and Lara were to stick around, all sorts of things could happen.
This is Richie Richardson, the captain, and his talents have never been more required. Well, that's four runs all the way. There's no third man. The man is deep and square, as Colin Croft pointed out to you. And that brings the 100 up. Glorious stroke. There's no indication, bodily indication anyway, that there's any pressure at all on Brian Lara or the West Indians. Well, that was a freak ball. It's going to be four byes. I don't think there's any danger of Richie Richardson getting back to ball there.
Well, if a ball could be scary from a spinner, this one must be. Not too short, just outside off stump. And bouncing probably higher than any of the fast bowlers have had the bounce today.
Depends if it's spun. If it was the top spinner, then the bowler has a chance.
But certainly worth a shout here. Perhaps outside off stump. Most batsmen will tell you the best place to sweep from is outside of off stump. That was pitch outside off.
What if he's outside off stump? Unless he's not playing a stroke, and that's what the situation was there. Well, he's taking a bit of a risk there. The umpires are not going to treat that in precisely the same way as they are a normal stroke. Some guy is just throwing his pad at the ball. Well, one, two more years of experience will teach the man at point that it's the second bounce that poses most problems. And that was the one. Bad ball from Embry. He doesn't have a deep backward square. Had one that was just about on deep square, but just asking to be swept. A wonderful shot. Quite brilliant. Playing against the spin. Beautiful footwork took him down right to the pitch of the ball. Never the slightest semblance of lofting it. Great positioning.
This is very clever bowling here by Watkins, and that one was actually pushed through. Pitched outside off, probably would have hit the off stump, but since the shot was played, there's no way you could be given out the LBW, but excellent bowling.
Also beautifully played. Good footwork by Richie Richardson. Some very good footwork and stroke play going on out there. Watkinson's down the boundary. A deep backward square for Lara.
Touch it.
something of a hard-hearted appeal here. Probably took the inside edge, getting onto the pad over the top of the man at the short extra cover.
Launched himself at that. Didn't quite get it, but the outfield is always likely to defeat any fielder out there today. It is hard and very fast. Too short. One too full, the other too short. Touch of inexperience there. Against one of the finest players in the world.
Yes, I just feel that Mike Watkinson is allowing Richie Richardson to play off the back foot all the time. And he's also allowing him too much width. The ball a little bit straighter, a little bit fuller. Try to induce the batsman to drive more. That's where he got his caught and bowled from.
That's going to race away fine. Four runs. Angus Fraser tried this round the wicket ploy at Keith Arterton. Those four runs bringing Brian Lara to the 50 mark. 52 not out. Well, a big whoosh, that's the technical term for that. Beat everyone.
Yeah, he threw this up, you see, big spin. Threw it up, little bit of air, enticing the batsman to play a front-footed drive. Big spin here, there's a lot of rough.
That's a fine shot. Four runs from the first ball of what will be Angus Fraser's last over of the day. Ah! Well, that's worth shouting for.
Well, I don't think Dickie will give it because he's a long way forward, but he didn't play a shot. As I said before, he tends to hide the bat. He's not even attempting to hide the bat there. He's just padding it off. Can you be sure he's going to hit the stumps? It's certainly worth a shout.
No more runs added, and the West Indies stayed at 159 for three at the close of play on this third day. That's a good partnership there. Great fight back between Brian Lara, who's in good form, 87 in the first innings, 59 not out in the second, and Richie Richardson, who is battling away out there and played pretty well. I thought his footwork was good today. A good sign for tomorrow, where the West Indies really need to bat with a great deal of discipline. He's unbeaten on 21. Campbell underlined his skill there, 44. And the ball was doing a bit out there. And Arterton, the victim of that unfortunate run out for 17. Jimmy Adams outthought by Watkinson, taking his wicket. One of the two he took for the innings. 159 for three in the bowling figures for England. Watkinson 2 for 36 and 11 overs and two maidens. And the others are wicketless. The other one went down with the run out. The state of the match at the close of play on the third day. England 437. West Indies 216, 159 for three. West Indies 62 runs behind. The incident with the bail falling off with Dominic Cork earlier in the day. This is a great shot. You can see how softly the bail falls just as the foot hits now. It really runs down the line of the stumps. There is a bit of a clunk there, but the bail just disappears. No one on the ground knew about it, and that's the way it happened. After that, Dominic Cork got back with the 4-all run, suddenly spotted the bale, and he said he wasn't aware the bale had come off, but he did say that Richie Richardson had asked the umpire why the bale was off, and Dominic himself thought the wicketkeeper could have done it accidentally. Umpire Cyril Mitchley comes in, sorts the whole thing out, and just turns. I'm not quite sure what he says as he turns away, but it may even have been to Richie Richardson, not out. A little shake of the head. Interesting times there. I've always said that cricket is the most controversial game of all, and I've seen nothing to dissuade me from that view in the last 40 years. Well, at the close of play, the hero of the day, so far as England were concerned, was Dominic Cork, and I talked with him with Tony Lewis.
Dominic, can I just congratulate you on your performance? I mean, you really enjoyed the batting, you could see that.
Yeah, I enjoyed it. It's not easy against the West Enders, they did test you out, but I just tried to stay out there as long as possible and try and get some runs.
And played some good shots.
Yeah, well, I tried and it seemed to come off and I had a little bit of luck.
Hmm. And the bowling in the first innings, you picked up 4 wickets, you were happy with that, Brian Lara included?
Yeah, I was happy with that. I thought I went for too many fours. I think I bowled a little bit too short. And I think again today I did this afternoon. But, you know, I'm going to try and put that tomorrow.
You picked up Brian Lara twice with a very good leg cutter, where he hasn't been coming forward all that much. We're still at that today, but didn't seem to be coming back.
Yeah, I was trying to bring it back at him, and it just wasn't coming back, whether I was not getting round in my action or whether the ball wasn't swinging, I don't know, but I'll be trying to do it tomorrow, and hopefully it will work.
He's a fine cricketer, Dominic Cork, and it's wonderful to see him so enthusiastic. Another enthusiast here, we have on my right-hand side this evening, Geoffrey Boycott, with his ideas on the state of the match.
Well, another good day for England as they slowly and surely ground West Indies down. Dominic Cork was the inspiration. Usually when West Indies fast bowlers take the new ball, they blow the tail enders away, but not today. Cork ran his singles quickly, injected some urgency into the proceedings. He played some exquisite back foot drives, and he kept the tail enders going. It was him that got England up to a smashing total. Then it was up to the bowlers to winkle out West Indies batsmen. Lara played a very fine innings again, and while he's there, West Indies supporters can always have hope, but I don't think it's going to matter. That pitch has still got something in it for the England bowlers. Even the seamers Angus Fraser and Dominic Cork passed the bat once or twice, and at the spin bowlers, it's very dry, worn, cracked. There's some rough there where the bowlers have put their feet, and all in all, there's something for all the England bowlers to work at. I expect England to win. They'll go to bed happy tonight. When they win, I don't know, but it will surely come.
Geoffrey Boycott with his ideas on what's happened in the game so far and what will be happening later on today. I've had a lot of fun here for the 3 days, and I can tell you that the West Indies are not yet out of the game, no matter what you might think. They're a very tough side, even though they've been beaten 3 times in recent months, and they'll be out there fighting and clawing away and trying to get back in to protect their 2-1 lead in this series. We'll be with you later on this morning, and we'll be on BBC One at 10:50 a.m. and hopefully it will produce a day of cricket to match the first 3 we've had here at Old Trafford, from where at the moment we say good night.
As it happened on the